think it's the Xiaomi.
No, definitely not actually. It's the Theta V. Best camera you can get for virtual tour.
Yeah, I mean, I like the Theta V, but you know, the Xiaomi is more detail.
More detail?
Well, yeah.
Detail is one thing, but exposure is another, and I think that's the more important thing.
Yeah,
so.
The dynamic range for sure.
Hey, there's a camera there filming us.
Oh, really?
I can see that.
Oh, hey guys.
Oh, hey.
Yeah, hey.
We're just having a conversation about what the best 360 camera is for virtual tours.
Mm-hmm.
I'm in the Theta V camp, and Michael's in the Xiaomi.
Yeah, and you know what? Let's put it to the test. Let's test it out.
Yeah,
yeah, there's no better way to find out, right?
Yeah, and what better place to test out the best virtual tour camera than in Tokyo, Japan. This is the view from the balcony of my Airbnb apartment. So why don't we check out inside my Airbnb as our first location, see what the exposure is like in mixed lighting.
Yeah, check it out, like what it's like to go inside the Japanese.
Yes.
Okay.
Welcome to my extremely messy apartment. You can find my underpants on the right hand side. My dirty socks.
Alright, that's part of the tour.
Yes. my camera gear everywhere, yes. Please.
Yeah.
Please make yourself at home.
Alright.
Camera gear all over, stuff charging. Time to get to business. Let's compare these cameras.
Alright. Hi, my name is Mick, and you're watching 360 Rumors, the resource that 360 shooters trust for in-depth camera reviews and innovative techniques.
It's Ben with the Theta V. It's gonna work his magic. So we have quite varying lighting here. We have strong light coming in out there, and lots of shadows in here. I think the Theta V is going to be good because it has HDR rendering. So I'm going to be shooting HDR rendering. And in this test, we're both going to do as much as we can to get a great result from the camera that we chose.
Mm-hmm.
So
using a mobile workflow only.
Yes.
And we've got like a time limit to make it fair.
Yes. 10 minutes each from shooting to editing. Let's do it.
Right.
All right, let's do this.
In one shot, it was able to render the fused image.
And straight away downloads in 1 second.
Yeah.
And
no doubt, if you don't want to do any editing, this is the best one straight out of the camera.
I mean,
compared to the Xiaomi, it's like way better.
He's already admitted defeat. Yay.
We'll see.
Look
don't
at
get cocky, Ben Claremont.
that exposure is looking really good. I'm happy with that shot. It's acceptable. A dynamic range is looking good.
Mm-hmm. The key word there is acceptable.
Yes. Yes, which is something that my camera will have that yours won't.
All right. So I've got the trusty Xiaomi. You know, the dynamic range isn't as good as some of the newer ones like the GoPro Fusion or even Insta 360 but what I like about it is the detail. And when you're doing virtual tours, my philosophy is that you have all the time in the world to do like a bracketed shot, and that's the key that will, I think, help us beat the Theta V. So let's find out. I'm gonna turn it on, connect with my app.
So let's try bracketing. Oh no, not supported. Well, if that happens, all you do is go back to your settings, tap settings, and go to your resolution. Make sure you're not shooting in RAW. Make sure you're shooting JPEG, because if you're in RAW, it's not going to let you do bracketing. And here, go back there. And you can use this to change the settings, all there for you. We're at ISO 50. And for base ISO, for best image quality, and now we're going to do bracketing. When you're bracketing, the kind of bracket that you choose, the interval, depends on not just the dynamic range of the scene, but also on the capabilities of the camera. If the camera's dynamic range is not that wide, and then you choose like, you know, plus 3 EV, then you're not going to have enough exposure latitude to match the exposures. So here, let's do like around 2. I think it's safe and it will be enough to cover the scene.
Yeah, this means 2 stops on either side of the correct exposure. So we're taking 3 photos total. One will be correct, one will be 2 stops underexposed, one will be 2 stops overexposed.
All right, I'm going to press the shutter now. Oh, Alright, so it did take longer than the built-in HDR, but let's do our exposure blending.
So here's my Theta V workflow. Firstly, I'll exit the app and I want to color grade my photo. I'm going to do that in Snapseed, and automatically the photo has been downloaded to my camera roll, so no more steps there. I'm just going to open that in Snapseed, and the exposure already looks great. I just want to make it maybe 20 or 30% better. Maybe boost the saturation a bit, bring down the highlights just a tad on those really strong highlights from outside, and maybe bring up the shadows just a little bit. It's all very intuitive within Snapseed, and if you don't own Snapseed, it'll be one of the best free downloads you ever download, so would suggest it. I'm gonna zoom in as I go and just make sure I'm happy with the areas of this image. I'm seeing a little tiny bit of purple fringing there, and Snapseed allows you to remove that. So firstly, I'm gonna zoom right in, and using the selective function, I'm gonna isolate that purple area, and see everything that's red there, that's my purple areas. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna desaturate them. So bye-bye chromatic aberration. Well, I can see it's removing a bit of the color from outside, so I just need to pinpoint that a bit better. So I can move it like that. And maybe I'll even reduce the size of the area I'm working on, and I'll make it a little bit more contrasty, and that's looking better. So bye-bye chromatic aberration. Now I'm going to have a quick look over the rest of the image. I'm pretty happy with that. There's not too much I would change. I think I'm done. I'm done within 2 minutes. I'm going to hit that export, save a copy to my camera roll, and my 360 photo is ready to go in around 2 minutes.
Alright, so now it's my turn.
So first, let's download the photos from the camera to the app. I'm launching the Mi Sphere camera, and I'm going to connect the camera. Tap on that. Then we're going to go to the gallery. Find the photos that we're going to download, select them by holding down my finger, click on download. Now on the Mi Sphere app, when you download the photo, it stitches it automatically. So give it a couple seconds. And they've been downloaded and stitched. So now they're in my phone. So the second step is to blend the three exposures. So to do that, I'm gonna go to my files and go to internal storage. I believe it's under DCIM, then MadV360, and there they are. So I'm gonna select them, 1, 2, and 3. And I'm gonna tap on share, and I'm gonna share them to this app called Vibrance HDR. That's an app that's gonna blend the three exposures together automatically for us. Thank you.
So let's see what it looks like.
Alright, first up we have Michael's image.
Right.
There we have it. Mm-hmm. That's looking good. I'm happy with that. It does seem contrasty.
Sure you did. I boosted the clarity a little too much just to show that you could do that with Google Photos, and it's not gonna create a seam. Check this out. Like, see, I'm panning the view, and normally when you edit a 360 photo and you change the highlights and you look at the left edge and the right edge when they meet, that point there will be a very distinct line, and here you can't see anything, and that's the benefit of this workflow that I just showed you guys.
Yeah.
So now let's check out the Theta V.
And look at that. That's beautiful. Oh, that's,
I think it's like very orange.
That's picture perfect. There's nothing I would change about that image. It's just absolutely stunning.
Let's look at the detail.
No, we don't need to do that. We don't need to do that.
Let's look at the window. Like, because I want to see the window too. This is HDR, right?
Yeah.
So, like, let's see how much you were able to capture.
I think there's a lot of highlight range there from what I'm seeing.
Like, what about the other one, the Mi Sphere?
Okay, let's open it. No, there's less detail with the Mi Sphere.
Maybe I should have used ±2.5 or something. But that's right, there's definitely more detail in there's more highlight range in the built-in HDR.
Yeah.
And I used bracketing, so that's amazing. But what about the detail?
Yeah. I would say the Mi Sphere definitely has more detail. Because the Mi Sphere look is more contrasty, I think that helps the blacks. And the blacks are what define that detail and that sharpness.
Mm-hmm.
So naturally, and obviously the Mi Sphere is higher resolution.
Oh, look at the clock. Let's see, like, what does it look like on... Yeah, I think...
Oh, yeah, more detail than the Mi Sphere.
Definitely more detailed.
Yeah.
So the question is, like, if you're going to meet, you're doing this for your virtual tour, which do you think
you would choose? It depends on your workflow. If you're someone that is comfortable with post-production, knows how to edit, mm-hmm. and knows how to color correct, most importantly, mm-hmm. then the Mi Sphere, I would actually change my vote and go to Mi Sphere if you're someone that knows that workflow. Mm-hmm. But if you would rather shoot quickly and have everything mm-hmm. inbuilt, maybe if you're doing smaller tours, say for smaller businesses, mm-hmm. and you need to be able to do your tour within under a day, and say you have 40 or 50 photos, it's mm-hmm. going to be really hard to do that with the Mi Sphere with all that post-production work.
Yeah, especially if you're like you're shooting for a Cupix tour where you have to take literally 50 shots for a single property, then, you know, a workflow like the one I showed you for the Mi Sphere would take too long.
Yes.
You know, it wouldn't justify the cost. Your client wouldn't pay for that. And so for that, I definitely agree the Theta V would be ideal for that.
Yes.
So check out the photos that we made. I've got the link to them, and you can check them out in the description below. So now the one question we didn't answer or ask actually even is, what about the Fusion compared to the Mi Sphere and the Theta V?
Yes. Well, yeah. I think...
For photos.
So I've previously made a video about that. Check out my YouTube channel, youtube.com/lifein360photo. If you want mm-hmm. to see my comparison on Fusion, Mi Sphere, mm-hmm. Insta360 One, and Theta V.
Mm-hmm.
And my winner was the Theta V, mm-hmm. and the Fusion came second. And they were almost mm-hmm. inseparable. The mm-hmm. Theta V won by a little bit, mm-hmm. but the Fusion is a lot more expensive. And now that the Fusion does shoot RAW...
Which is what I was going to talk about.
I remade that video, I think the Fusion would win.
You know what, right? Like right now, after they came up with the RAW workflow, I think, the Fusion is actually better than the Mi Sphere overall.
Yes.
For photo, even considering the detail.
And considering its lower resolution than the Mi Sphere.
Yes. And, you know, you do have to know what you're doing with RAW. And, you know, you all know all the caveats with the Fusion. You need a dedicated graphics card, all that stuff. But if you have it, then it will produce the best results.
And
I
you
think
know
we
what?
We both agree about that.
And you know what? The mm-hmm. GoPro Fusion is notorious for having a really painful workflow. Mm-hmm. Don't forget, we're working with photos with virtual tours.
Yes.
It's videos that produce the issue. So mm-hmm. the Fusion is absolutely a camera that is workable quite easily mm-hmm. regardless of the computer you own. Because mm-hmm. you're not dealing with several gigabytes worth of files. You're dealing mm-hmm. with several megabytes.
Yes.
So workflow isn't an issue with the Fusion.
Right.
I'm also working on a more comprehensive virtual tour camera comparison. It will include the best 360 cameras for photography, including future 360 cameras. I'll also include DSLR and fisheye lens recommendations to take your virtual tours to the next level.
Until next time, be sure to capture your world in 360.
And we'll see you in 360.
Alright, ciao.